to the Father, we take circumstances and situations and we say, I trust you, God. Let's do that. Father, we're grateful that we can trust you. And that no matter what else is occurring, we know that you are God, that you are omnipotent, you are sovereign, you are in charge, you are Lord. You are the one who has the ability and the authority to make decisions and enforce it and act them. We submit to that authority. And we bow and we rest in the comfort of knowing that you have promised that all things are going to work together for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And we rejoice that that's us. Thank you, Father, for your love and your care and your promise to take care of every need that we have when our focus is on you. And so today, Lord, we pray for our country, because the focus of most of our country, obviously, Father, not judgmentally from us, but obviously, is not on you. We pray for those who need to turn their face back to you. We pray for those who need to turn their face for the first time to you. We pray for those in power and authority as you commanded us to pray for them. And I pray, God, that you would influence them in ways that would be honorable toward you, and that you would stop them in ways that would not bring you glory. Take care of the needs that they have so that they can know that you're God and that they'll follow your leadership and your lordship. Father, we trust, though, that what you're doing is better for your gospel, and we give you honor and glory for that. Well, Father, we also pray for other folks. There's a lot of lost people that we know. There's people who need to know Jesus, and we know them, and we've talked to them, and we've shared with them, and they just don't seem to respond, and they're on our heart, and you put them there, Father, and so we pray for them. We know that no amount of our accusing and finger-pointing and explaining and praying focusing so much on them will cause them to respond only your spirit with that. So we ask, Father, in this prayer, that you'll move in that way with them. You'll draw them close to you. You'll take the seeds of the gospel that have been planted on them, and you'll reach into their heart. You'll draw them to you so that they may know the peace and comfort of knowing Jesus is Savior. Thank you, Father, for that peace. Pray for the needs in this room, the ones represented in this room. We have some in the hospital today. We know that your presence is there, and I pray, God, you help them to feel that. We have some who are careful and not coming to the room today. And, Father, again, let them know that you're with them just as much as you let us know here in the room. Use us here. Let us speak your words. Be with this preacher that his words are not his. Honor and glory, and that today we may be different. In Jesus.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I am lost, the one. Thank you.
ways to be sure, that's what we're going to be looking at during the month of January. And there are a lot of ways to be the church, aren't there? And I've come up with a bunch of examples of that to be able to work with and to help us see a lot of different ways we can do that. And I've kind of used the ABCs. I learned those when I was in school. Thank you, school teachers, for teaching things like the ABCs, because they come in handy. And we talked about last week accepting the ownership of God. God owns the church. God owns you. You are not your own. You have been bought with a price, and the church is His beloved bride.
Amen.
That's us. Accept the ownership of God. He is Lord over the church. Remember, Lord? It means He's the one with the right, the authority, the ability to make decisions and enact those decisions, because He owns us. He gets to make the decisions. We don't. Wednesday night, we looked at the B, believe the Bible. And we could have gone all kinds of directions as we studied that to look and see why historically and why academically and why philosophically and all of those things we should accept the Bible. But the reality is, Jesus accepted the Bible. And it tells us about Jesus. And if you don't get in and look and see what the Bible says to help you understand who Jesus is, you're not going to have a saving faith in Him. Your saving faith will be in your thoughts about Him and how wonderful He must be, sitting up there on His cloud, playing His little harp, and looking down on all of us wonderful people that He just loves so much. And you will miss the part that says He is a jealous God, that He has vengeance and it is His. And He says, "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord." And that people will spend eternity in darkness, separated from Him, where there will be, according to the Bible, weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. And if you don't go to the Bible to get your idea of who this Jesus is, in whom we must put our faith, your faith will be faulty from the first, and it will fail. I'm telling you. So, Wednesday night, believe the Bible is where we were. Today is the C. And the Lord has led me to an interesting C for today. It's one that we don't like. And in a way, it fits the A, except ownership of God. Here's the C. Cater to the will of God. Cater to the will of God. Accept the ownership of God. Believe the Bible. Cater to the will of God. You know God has a will. God not only has a will, but He is Lord. He has the authority to enact that will. That's who He is. And how and when and where and why and you know, in what manner He chooses to enact that will, with what amount of force and coercion, or what amount of loose leash and freedom, it's His choice. He gets to decide. But from my point of view and from yours, as servants of Him, whom the Bible talks to and tells us that we are owned by Him, our position is to be ready to do the will of God as it is revealed to us by the God whose will it is. I mean, let's go to the Bible and see how this follows through. 1 John chapter number 2. 1 John chapter number 2. And one of the great things I find in the book of 1 John is this. You can go through and you can find more than 20. And if you want to stretch some thoughts and really reach into the deep context of it all, you can find even more than that. Reasons why Jesus came. You can find them in 1 John. If you just go through and you read 1 John, you're going to find out that he talks about just about every aspect of life and his influence on it. And you're going to see how his influence was there as part of the reason that he came. Mostly Jesus came to be the spotless sacrifice, to be the perfect Lamb of God, to pay the price, because we're a bunch of dirty, rotten, heathen sinners who need redemption. That's mostly why Jesus came. And we do need that, don't we?
Yeah.
I mean, all of sin, all of comes short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death. And if I can die because of my sin. You can put me to death because I'm a sinner. Guess what? I'll stop sinning.
But my sins won't be covered because I'm not a spotless lamb. Somebody else had to die in order for my sin to be covered, for me to have eternity with the Father, to be in that peace, in that rest with Him. Wonder what heaven's going to be like. The Bible talks a lot about it. We're going to know one another. And we're going to understand things that we don't understand now. We're going to know God as He knows us. I wonder if we'll be able to learn there and ask questions. I wonder if we'll have feet. Have you ever wondered that? It talks about a street of gold. Are we going to have feet to walk on it, or are we going to hover over it? Are we going to have a physical body that looks similar to the one? Well, I hope not. You know what I'm saying? What's it going to be like? We don't know. The songwriter had it right. We can only imagine. But you can just keep on imagining what the full experience would be like if you have not given your heart to Jesus Christ, the spotless Lamb, who died your death for you to pay the wages of your sin so that you could have eternal life. You can't miss that part of it. We can't miss that that's why He came. We can't miss that that's what He's about. Even though the wages of sin is death, because Jesus came, there is a free gift from God, and it's eternal life in Christ.
Amen.
Don't miss it. Don't miss that. And then, as 1 John, the same apostle that wrote the book of John, the same apostle that wrote the Revelation that we see later, the same apostle that wrote, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in this," the same apostle that wrote, "I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go, I'll come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." I'm getting happy about that. I don't know about y'all. But listen, the same guy that wrote that wrote these words in the 15th verse of chapter 2 of 1 John. He wrote these words: "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." Hard words. Verse 16. "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever." Now this morning I just want to simply dissect that little passage of Scripture for you. I want to begin with this premise: God has a will. He has a specific, pointed, individual will for you and for me. His will for me in some places will overlap with His will for you. For instance, it is His will that none should perish, but all should come to repentance. That overlaps everybody, doesn't it? It's His will that we should worship Him and follow Him. But how that plays out in my life will be a little different than how it plays out in your life. And there will be some separation there in how it works. But it all comes back to the same God with the same will, who is working in and through all things to bring glory to Himself and to lead us to understanding Him better, so that in eternity we will have a home with Him. He has a will. We begin with that premise. And because of that premise, there is a command. You see, His will is much higher than His creation. I've got to pause there. Because when He gives us this command, "Do not love the world or the things in the world," that's the command. I want you to see that He is placing His will, He is placing His lordship over you. He is placing the things He wants you to do and the people that He wants you to be. He is placing all of that lower than the reality of who He is and His will for you. You see, all things were created by Him, as St. John writes. And without Him was nothing made that was made. He made it all. And all of it is under Him. The Bible teaches us that the earth is the footstool of the Lord. That's a comparison to show us how vast God is and how small we are. And one of the things that we need to understand in a discussion of the will of God is that He is not some legislator sitting at the head of a group of people making decisions and passing laws just simply because they can. Rather than that, he is the supreme, almighty, creator, sovereign, independent God who is holy above all, fully capable of sustaining or detaining, of continuing or stopping all of creation. When we try to understand God and his will only in the context of the creation in which we live, we are going to miss what he has to say to us. We're going to miss the fullness of the will of God and the meaning of it. We're going to miss it if we don't understand that his ways are higher than ours. His thoughts are greater than ours, for he himself is much more than we. That's who God is, and he has a will. And as he gives us this command, there is a reminder, if you will, in this phrase, that the world is not what we're longing for. It's not what we're going for. You know, we're all worried about what's going to happen politically and socially and economically and all of that kind of stuff. And if you're not worried about it now, maybe you were worried about it 4 years ago. I don't know. But we've been worried about this forever and what's going to happen and how it's all going to be. And we are so concerned about all this stuff and how much is gas going to cost and are we going to stay at war and are we going to have to continue all the lockdowns and wearing the masks and all this thing. Okay? We just worry about, let me say, all that stuff is of the world. Okay? How much money you have at the bank to go buy how many groceries with, that's of the world. Do we have to care about that? Well, sure. Do we have to make sure we got groceries in the house, a little bit of money in the bank, and some gas in the car? Sure. I mean, those are the realities of our life that we live in. But when we're talking about the will of God, we have to get beyond the physical. It's absolutely necessary. So John writes, do not love the world. He writes it under the inspiration of God. All scripture is given, it's breathed out, if you will. It's given by inspiration from God, profitable for every aspect of our life. And he writes this, don't love the world or the things of the world. If you hold on to all this stuff so tight, and then you turn on whatever your favorite news outlet is, you are going to fall into such a grand depression that no amount of pills and therapies and everything else can take you out of it. Tell him. But if you simply know that you exist in the world, but you don't love the world, you do your business in the world, you take care of the things that you're given to have responsibility over in the world, you care about your family, and you take care of your car. Yesterday, we fixed a car. Betsy had to fix a thing on her car, and she got the rinse helped out, and she even got her fingernails greasy. I mean, it's just... I'm telling you, we had a fun time doing that. We took care, got to take care of stuff, right? Got to have food in the pantry. Got to have a little money for the gas tank. All those things got to be. Got to pay your insurance bill. And if you don't pay your electric bill, then you know your food in your refrigerator is going to go bad. And you just got to take care of all that stuff. But don't make that the love of your life. Don't love the world or the things that are in the world. Don't make that the point of your existence. Some of the most unhappy people I've ever seen or heard of are some of the richest people whose the point of their existence is simply just get one more and one more and one more. And then, now, mind you, I'd like to have one more. Would you like to have one more? Would you like to have one more? One more what? You fill in the blank, right? I want one more dollar, and I want one more, you know, a truck, and I want one, you know. I want one more. I don't want one more. One's enough of that. He says, don't love the world. Why? Because if anyone, this is the text again in verse 15, if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. That's the why behind the command, do not love the world or the things of the world. Because you will get so caught up in the things of the world that you will miss the love of the Father. One of the best ways, I'm not talking about being judgmental to anybody, but one of the best ways to tell if somebody's heart is really with the Lord is you'll look at what they're worried about and what they care about and what they put most of their attention on. Yeah. If it's the things of the world,
where their love is. The Bible says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So lay up not for yourself treasures on earth where moth and dust have corrupt, but lay them up in heaven where they can. That's where your treasure is. That's where your heart is. Don't love the world or the things of the world. Listen, if you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you. It is an indication that you have had a religious experience, but you might not have had a real experience with the Father. There's a big distinction there in church, folks. We understand that. It's an if you're concerned more about whether or not you've got a can of corn sitting in the cupboard than you are about somebody coming to Jesus, than you are about knowing and doing the will of God in your life, then you've got your concern in the wrong place. By the way, y'all have two cans of corn in the cupboard, but the corn's young. It's dumb. But don't love it. Maybe God will make you have black-eyed peas instead of corn. Some people want to do. Those of you going do, it's your fault. Don't love the world or the things of the world, because if you love the world, the love of the Father, it's an indicator. It will show you. So what's he talking about? Verse 16, here's what we're not supposed to love. Verse 16 tells us, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Now, this is a good seminary verse, because in seminary, they tell you if you're having trouble with a text, just keep reading until you find three things. Here's three things. There are three things that are in opposition to us hearing and seeing and knowing the comfort and the will and the knowledge and the lordship of the Father and having that active in our life. Only three. In fact, you don't have to worry about the rest of the law. Worry about these three. Here they are. The lust of the flesh. The lust of the flesh. Is that talking about sexual immorality? Yep. Is that talking about excessively desiring all the stuff and the things? Yep. Is it talking about always wanting one more? Yep. Here's the thing. The lust of the flesh is anything that will satisfy this body, if only for a moment. Whatever it might be. It might be a good meal. It might be a fancy car. It might be a comfortable chair in front of a huge screen TV with three different kinds of surround sound so that you can have all the different kinds of things. You know, when you watch Star Trek, you can hear the machinery running over here while Captain Picard's talking over there. And you're sitting in your comfy chair, and that might be it, because it's comfortable to the flesh. And that's what it's talking about. We can spend hours here dissecting that and calling it what it is. We can talk about music, can't we? What are you listening to in some of that music? I mean, I'm not saying one style is better than another. I'm not saying one genre is godly and another genre is not godly. But what are you filling your mind with when you're like, I don't listen to the words, I just do. But you're sitting there mouthing every word. You know? I'm telling you. Well, what about that TV show? My grandmother, who passed away back in the 80s, she had to watch her stories every day. When we would go to visit her when I was a little kid, we'd go visit Grandma during story time. She was watching her stories. My mom always kept me busy doing something else during her stories. What are you filling your mind with? I was visiting with a pastor yesterday from another town, and he was telling me about a lady that was in a church that he ministered to at one point, and she would read one of those novels. You know, those ones that start with a harlequin? And end with a harlequin heart. Yeah, that. Those. She would read one of those every day. Yet she was always at church and always doing a thing and gave her money and helped out and taught in Bible school and stirred the Kool-Aid and she taught children on Sunday and she went to camp and just everybody. She, every day. She read her Bible to us. She did the Bible better than she knew those books. But every day she'd read a story. What is it that gives comfort to your flesh?
a bad thing. Might not. It depends on whether you can attach to that that I am lusting for it. In other words, my whole desire is pointing toward that thing. All I'm doing is working hard so I can buy a new recliner to put in front of my new TV set to watch me. If that's all you're living for, you are a shallow individual, I'm telling you. And it'll cause you to show where your love is. So don't love the world for the things it's in it. It is illustrated in your desire for the things of the flesh. Okay to desire some things of the flesh. And draw that line there, though. I love a good steak. You play with me on that? I love a good steak. But if my whole life is about going to give me another big old slab of ribeye, that's what we're going for lunch. Listen. If my whole life is about giving me another ribeye, that's a shallow example. To satisfy my desire, to satisfy my want for that thing, I am showing that I don't love the Father, that I love the world. And I'm writing to us in this verse of God. Don't love the things in it. Illustrated by the things that satisfy the body. Also, the lust of the eyes. The lust of the eyes. So-and-so has it, I want it. Oh, isn't that just the prettiest thing? Oh, the things that satisfy that, not just the things that satisfy our comfort and make us feel good, but the things that look good. I'm going to tell you that one of the country music singers had it right when he said, everything that glitters is not gold. Everything that's pretty is not content-making. Everything that looks like it just might be delicious, you don't want to touch. Have you watched some of these food commercials on TV? Those scoops of ice cream that they put there, and they just look so yummy and so delicious. You know that they're not ice cream. Often, those are raw bread dough or mashed potatoes. Now, can you imagine putting a scoop of strawberry topping with cream and cherry on a pile of mashed potatoes? But boy, it looks good on TV, doesn't it? It sure looks good when you see it on TV.
Do you want us to go Facebook Live?
Take care of him, okay? All right. Listen. There's a weird one in every crowd. There you go. But let's make this go a little bit further. Let's combine it with the lust of the flesh, the things that satisfy the body. It begins by the things that you're looking at. And we have pornography is an example of those things that the images will never get out of your mind. And we have the other person's girlfriend, boyfriend, wife, husband. Never get out of your mind. That good-looking guy on the screen, on the movie there. Some of that stuff never gets out. We begin to see it with our eyes. We go over to our buddy's house who God has blessed financially a little bit more than we do, and he has a 65-inch TV, and we've only got a 48-inch. I see it, we begin to want it. It turns into lust in our flesh, and we begin to go out. And there's nothing wrong with having a 60, there's nothing wrong with having an 85. Listen, if you want to cover a whole wall in your house with video screen, put a Trinitron, or a, what do you call that thing at the football stadium, that middle thing, Yeah, that thing. If you put that thing, if you want to put one in your house, go for it, Nothing wrong with having it, unless it becomes the guiding factor of your life. So be careful, little eyes, what you see. For the Father up above is looking down. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Here's one that really gets us. I mean, we're good Christian folks, and we're not looking at the magazines that we shouldn't see the pictures on, and the pictures on our screens that we shouldn't be seeing. And we're not really caring too much about what kind of car we drive. And thank you, Lord, for just decent house to live in that keeps the rain and the cold out, and for a couple of cans of corn in the cupboard. Thank you for those things, and I'm satisfied right there. But what about the pride of life? Why did he have to put that one in there? The who I am in this life. The what other people think of me in this life. Can I remind you that it's none of my business what other people think of me. If you come to me and you say, so-and-so said this about you, you're not going to get an all-ears-open response, because I don't care. At least I try not to care. Sometimes I care more than I should. I'll give you a transparent moment there. But I shouldn't. None of my business what people think. It's my business to live for the Lord and be concerned about what He thinks of me. That's my business. The pride of life says, though, that it matters more what they think of me than it matters whether they're saved. Maybe that person that is lashing out at you and being ugly toward you or your person or your family or your... Oh, they're getting my family. They say whatever they want to about me, but not my family. Pride of life can be part of that response. Should you defend your family? Most of the time. Sometimes we think we need to defend something that requires no defense. We've got to be careful. We've got to make good choices there. But listen, the pride of life is I have, I got, I am, and you better not mess with it. I have this, don't mess with my stuff. I am this, don't mess with me. I believe in or whatever this, and we do that with a lot of our American isms that we have and our loyalty to our country. Should be loyal to our country. All of that, I'm a proud veteran, the United States military, all that stuff, obviously. We ought to stand up and salute the flag. We ought to honor veterans, and we ought to be grateful for the sacrifices that everyone of us willing to make. We ought to respect and honor every office holder that has been elected and put there. Every one of them. Whether we voted for them or not.
Right.
Enough said on that. But the pride of life says, I don't like that person. The pride of life says, that person was mean to me and I've got to get revenge. The pride of life says, that person thinks differently than I do. And because they think differently than I do, I can't be around them or know them. And we let all of those things get in the way that we are so good because we are such a wonderful Christian person that we can't be around those sinners. Remember, Jesus went and ate with sinners. And He went and spent time with them. He didn't go sinning with sinners. But He was with them. He was with the people. He confronted sometimes, and sometimes He just let it go. The people that were so apt to try to tear Him down and that were trying to be His demise causer, the person that caused His demise. And he stayed with them. Even on the cross. Father, get that one. He put the nail on it. Father, forgive them. Father, that's the guy who started, crucify him over there at the trial. Get him. Father, forgive them.
Right.
For they don't even understand what's going on in their life. They know not what to do. The pride of life will keep you from having a heart that wants to see people forgiven of their sin and spend eternity in heaven. You will be the person who will say about an individual, well, I hope they rot in hell for what they did to me. Pride of life. Heard that come out of Christian person's mouths. It makes one curious of their salvation. The pride of life will keep you from engaging in a conversation when the Spirit of God is impressing on you. Go talk to that person about Jesus. The pride of life will keep you from helping an individual who really needs help because you're so much better than they are. And it affects your lust of your eyes, the things that you have seen, and your lust of the flesh, the things that you desire to have and fulfill yourself with, and it will keep you from doing the chore that is the most significant in this world, and that is getting the gospel of Jesus Christ into the hands of somebody. All that is in the world can be characterized by one of these three things, and so if you look at who you are and what you do and take an inventory of your life, and you say, what about this part of me? What about this thinking process? What about these words? What about this thing that I have? What about this desire that I have? It's going to fall into one of those categories. And John here is indicating not that seeing something and wanting it is bad, not that wanting to enjoy a good meal is bad, not even that being discerning about people around you is bad, but making that the point of your life is not what God has called us to do, and it is anti to the will of God. So don't love the world or the things of the world, for if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And all that is in the world is not of the Father, but it's of the world. And he reminds us that there is a wind to this thing, a timing of it, for all that is in the world is passing away. And the lust of it, it's going to go away. That brand new TV that you just have to have, it's going to start getting little speckles on the screen. And it's going to quit. Or a windstorm's going to blow down the cable line and you can't watch your show anyway. All that's in the world, it's passing away. And so your ability to have a desire for it is passing away. Young, strong bodies turn into old, less than enticing bodies. And it passes away. Cars need constant repairing and will eventually pass away and won't be able to do what they need to do. Hair that is beautiful today will one day have to have so much extra care to make it a different color if you don't like what it's going to become, because it's not going to stay like it is today. All that is in the world is passing away. The house is going to fall down. The clothes are going to wear out. The food is going to be eaten or go rotten. And it's all going to pass away. And all of the desires that you have for it, listen, it's going to be gone too. But,
one of my favorite words in Scripture,
but he who does the will of God abides forever. What's he talking about here? I'll finish it up real quick because this is easy. That this part of the verse is so easy. I mean, it's easy peasy, lemon squeezy. It's just you can't beat how easy this is. What is the will of God? Look at what it says the will of God results in. Abiding forever. The will of God, he who does this, abides forever. And what does the Bible teach us causes us to abide forever? Whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Gonna abide forever, right? It's a real simple thing. The will of God, that which causes us to abide forever, has absolutely nothing to do with computers, TVs, cars, houses, clothes, hair, health, food, anything. Has nothing to do with what he said or she said or what they think of me or what I think of them. Has nothing to do with how high on the corporate ladder I can climb or how much money I can put in the bank, and has everything to do with believing in the name of the only begotten Son of God to abide forever. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, who himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father. What are we talking about? We're talking about the will of God. Listen, it is his will that you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead so that you will be saved. That's his will. What does that mean? That means when I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, that I have fallen under the leadership, the dictatorship, if you will. Some people aren't going to like that word, but you understand what I'm saying to you. That you fall under the Godship, the sovereignty, the lordship of our Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, you have confessed that he is the one who has the ability, the authority to choose and enact those choices upon us every single day of our life, and we will submit to them. And if that means we get to live rich and peaceful, then we get to live rich and peaceful. If that means we get to live poor and uncomfortable, then we get to live poor and uncomfortable. But we realize that those things are of the world and those things are passing away, but we're going to abide forever in a place that's called rest. What are we saying? God has a will, and you need to cater to the will of God, which means you need to point every aspect of your life toward the reality that God has a will for. And if God gives you that great big car, use that great big car for His glory, because that's what matters in the end. If God gives you a great big bank account, use that great big bank account for His glory, because that's what matters in the end, because He receives glory when lost people come to the Lord's Savior. So today I ask you, as we finish up, have you submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ? He has a book for you to play out, if you will.
I don't like that.
The book's written down. It's there. He knows. He's seen the book before you were ever born. He knows. And without any indication or discussion of any other part of that story, He has a willing desire for your life. First, that you come to Christ, then that you follow Christ. Maybe today you need to do the first. You need to come to Christ. Maybe today you need to recommit to the second, to follow Him. So in a moment, I'll ask the musicians to come, and then I'll pray, stand, sing. Maybe you need to respond by walking from the place where you'll be standing in front of this auditorium. Right? Maybe by yourself. Won't bother you listening to me. Maybe today you need to come and you say, I'm not praying to God. Maybe today, just maybe today, you need to say, I'm not going to love the world. And the things of the world, which are passing away, because I want to be my Father. Father. Please bow your heads and close your eyes. No one is looking for Him. First Peter tells us, therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourself with the same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of men, but for the will of God. Would you determine today that you're going to follow the will of God? Father, I pray for those around me, those in my hearing today, that as you call, we will follow. As you give a command, we will respond. As you show us your desires, we'll accept it. Cause us today to understand that you are Lord and you have a desire for us, and help us to follow that, Father. Give us the grace we need to do that. Maybe we need a little help with that. Maybe we need a lot. Father, we trust you today to help us. Should someday you make even worse news, I pray that this would be the day you'd move in our lives. God, be glorified now in what's happening as we respond. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Stand with me, please, as we stand, as we sing. God's dealing with you. You come, would you please?
Thank you guys for checking in with us today at Second Baptist Church. We're really glad you were here. Hope today God spoke to you, that you thought about God's will for your life and what He wants you to do and who He wants you to be. And if you need to talk about that some today, we'd just love to do that. On this forum, there's a lot of contact information. There's snail mail, there's email, there's direct messaging, there's just simply leaving a comment. Whatever you want to do, we'd love to hear from you. We'd love to reach out to you if you'll just let us know. And we're praying for you that God will work in your life and that you will be His vessel on this earth. God bless you. We'll see you next time that we get together here from Second Baptist Church.